Good evening, one and all. Today, on behalf of Indian Psychiatric Society, our journal branch, today we are having the guest lecture being organized by the subcommittee, the Samanvi Women Empowerment Committee. The first program started this year, 2021-22. They are taking a lead role. First program being organized by the subcommittees of this year 2021-22. First of all, I would like to invite Dr. Ramana Narat, the President IPS South Zone, to preside over the today's function. And the President-elect Dr. Uday Kumar, Honorary Editor Sahul Amin, Honorary Treasurer Dr. K. Gangaram, and the Samanvi Committee Chairperson Dr. Radhika Reddy, Co-Chairperson Dr. Indumati, and other members of the Samanvi, Nivedita, LC Women, and Aruna Ediyar, and senior members and their friends, colleagues, and various members, other members of the doctors community and other non-doctors community, they have joined today's function. Today is an important guest lecture, particularly doctors. We have the Samanvi has chosen a very nice topic on the financial literacy and independence, the key tool for women empowerment. This is very important, not only for women, it is also useful for men, where particularly doctors community has very poor in financial management. It is a very nice topic that's chosen by the Samanvi committee. We are all getting enlightened by today's topic. I invited the guest speaker, Shama Raghavan Menon, the Vice President of Risk Department, Axis Bank, Mumbai. Madam, please come onto the screen, madam. And for this program, the chairing by Dr. K. Ramakrishnan, he initiated the program of Women Empowerment Committee subcommittee initiated in the last year. He shouldered all the responsibilities and sharing his ideas. The Women Empowerment Committee, the brainchild of K. Ramakrishnan, still he is supporting today and readily consented for today's program as a chairperson of today's program. I invite you, sir. Ramakrishnan, sir. We have other programs like subcommittees and all. We are planning to have many programs, so particularly Visor and a psychiatric update program we are launching during ANSIPS, and the Visor committee you have part-time CME, particularly on Sundays we want to plan. We have very other programs, various in addition to regular mental health activities we want to conduct. Now I request Dr. Ramana Narat to take over and to preside over the today's function. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you for introducing the topic, and welcome everybody.
Please unmute any audience. Please unmute, other speaker will have.
I welcome everybody, especially I welcome the new members of the Samanvi community, especially Dr. L.C. Uman and Dr. Aruna. All the others are known to everybody. We have the Samanvi started last year, focusing mainly on issues related to
the women empowerment, neither the psychiatrist, ladies.
Last year we dealt with mostly the psychological issues on this year, I think the first topic is going to be the financial literacy and its effect on women empowerment. I think financial literacy is, as we are concerned, I think it's very, very, very important, because even as doctors, most of us are not very, literate in the financial management. Though we earn money, we don't know how to invest and how to you know, select the investments and things like that. And probably, Dr. Today,
I found a movie that I wanted to watch. It's a Malayalam movie.
It is brief introduction to the topic as well as the opening remarks. I'll be handing over to Dr. Radhika Reddy to further proceedings because I'll be leaving shortly because I have to go out for it because I'm on vacation. Please excuse me. I think Dr. Radhika Reddy, please excuse me for that and continue with that for the session.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Your presence.
I'll be there. For
yes, sir. Your presence and blessings, sir, should be there for Samanvi. Thank you very much, sir. And on behalf of Samanvi, I welcome all the participants for this program. And first of all, let me welcome Kshama Raghavan, our speaker today, and Dr. Ramakrishnan, sir, accepted as to be the chief guest for this first 21-22 first program from South Zone Women's Subcommittee, Empowerment Committee. And it is actually a brainchild of Dr. Ramakrishnan, sir. Last year, we have conducted around 5 to 6 meetings similarly. And this is our first program for this year. And this topic is a very much essential topic for all of us. For all the doctors, especially lady doctors, and also for men also, as our secretary was mentioning. So we, our professionalists, are very poor in our financial management. So definitely, we can as well give that statement. We are not well versed in that area. So we will be listening to our speaker acquired some knowledge regarding this and utilize that in our financial management. And today, let me introduce our chief guest, who requires no introduction actually. If I read out all the bio and the achievements of our ex-president South Zone, it will take a lot of time. Excuse, sir. I am just giving only a few major things from this bio data. For those who doesn't know about Dr. Ramakrishnan, sir, they will be knowing all these things. So Dr. K. Ramakrishnan is a consultant psychiatrist and managing director from Atma Hospitals. And he is also vice chairman for Red Cross Society at Trichy. And he's a convener for homeless persons with the mental illness in Indian Psychiatry Society, National Task Force Committee. President for South Zone Indian Psychiatry Society branch in 2021. And he also worked as president in 2016 for Tamil Nadu State branch. And has many awards and many publications. Awards he was in a few. There were one arts honored by collector of Karur on Independence Day. Ceremony award, MS Ashraf Award. VKR Award, Dr. VKR Award, Acharya Award, and Heroes of Rehab Award by World Association for Psychosocial Rehabilitation, and Award of Excellence, honored by American Association for Social Advancement in India, and also many awards from Rotary Clubs and Lion Clubs, and Life Achievement Award by JITV also. And many publications are there in his pocket, and many social service activities he has done since 2003 to till date, and many social service achievements and so many things. So I welcome Dr. Ramakrishnan, sir, and one more great thanks to you, and because sir has sponsored this program. As when we were looking for financial support for this, sir has readily agreed and he sponsored this. And thank you very much for that, sir. And I would like to say one thing, like you have to felicitate the speaker also with a small memento from Sammanvi, which Dr. Arun will be showing to all the audience and participants. Dr. Arun, please can you?
Yes, ma'am.
This is the memento. Shema madam, we will be handing over to you by the hands of Ramakrishnan sir. We will be posting to you, madam. We could not see Shema Raghavan madam. Please switch on your video, madam.
Yes.
Very good evening to all, and thank you so much for the memento.
Yes,
means a lot.
Thank you, madam. Sir, I would like to hand over to Dr. Ramakrishnan, sir.
Good evening to all of you. At the outset, I thank the IPS office bearers, Dr. Ayrat, Dr. Suresh Kumar, Dr. Arun Kumar, and other people, and also the Samanvi members of IPS South Zone for giving me this opportunity to chair this session. And there are two new bright stars entered into the Samanvi, apart from Dr. Radhika Reddy being the chairperson. Indumati is the co-chairperson, Nivedita. These were all the previous members. The new stars of this Samanvi are L.C. Oman and Dr. Aruna Edia. And I am proud to welcome them also for this meeting. And we will do justice for this purpose for which the Samanvi we have started. We all know that doctors are poor manager, accounts manager, financial managers. That is one thing. And nowadays, women, doctors are becoming more and more entrepreneurs. Many of the managing directors of hospitals are women. Like that, things are moving. Previously, we didn't think much about how to manage and other things. See, this women managing the account is not new. Many, usually from the beginning, the husband will earn the money and give it to wife. And she will give the share to all other things. And also, she will put a share for saving. Like that, even from village, uneducated people, it was there. And after that, people started much better. They started putting chit, chit funds. And many people, when they come to me for consultation, sir, so without my knowledge of my husband, I used to invest in chit, sir. That's what people will be telling. And then they started lending money, you know. Many women, even without knowing the thing, informing the husband, they used to lend money. And sometime or other, they end up in soup and they lose money. See, at that time also, I used to tell, have a good advice. Don't think that a husband should not know. What they would say is, suppose I do it, he'll grab that money also for spending. So these are the ways. People are always conscious about saving money and investing in a proper way. So this is the right time. The topic has come. And there is no other good person we can have than Shama. Starting her ranks from Axis Bank after qualifying in Axis as a chartered accountant from 2003. If you see her CV, it is going for 10 pages. And she has held so many ranks. See, it is not, she has not just jumped. And it is not that she was given a honor of vice president. She has earned her achievements. And now she holds one of the most important portfolios for a bank, that is investment and achieve this thing. So we all hear from her, watch her advice, to women, young psychiatrists, as well as some geriatric psychiatrists like Yarat. Welcome, madam. Welcome for the time you are given for this lecture.
Thank you so much, sir. I think it means a lot to me then to you too, because you have been forebearers and taking us through these tough times. COVID has shown us what the world can be and how sitting at home we all can be affected. It can be, I mean, it's my honor to be in this group and teach you very little of what I know. I've been listening to you, sir. I'm just taking some points, Dr. Ramakrishna, sir, from your points as to how we used to manage. And you had an excellent example of how even way back housewives used to manage. So I'm taking cues from there. And I thank Dr. Nivedita to introduce me to this group and forum. Again, it's a privilege. I'll start with some of some basic, maybe most of this you would already know, but some basic PowerPoint or PDF on this entire presentation and what we are talking about, finance. So to start with, probably these are broadly the topics which I'll be covering today. If I am too fast or too slow, anyone can just interrupt and ask me to change my pace. So I'm just talking about basic financial literacy, planning, budgeting, investment, and some loan options. We were talking about women entrepreneurs, and I see that increasingly even when I work in a bank. So I'll just quickly go through them. So when we talk about financial literacy, we talk about mainly it is beyond earning, because as everyone was mentioning that as doctors, you have a lot of time which you spend in clinics. And so beyond earning, how do you plan your financials? How do you manage your financials is all about financial literacy. So it is not just earning, but it is also financial planning, budgeting, and investing. By financial planning, I mean you identify the revenue streams. You might be a consultant somewhere. You might have your own hospital. You might be working somewhere. So identify what revenue you actually get. Then you break up your revenue into salary versus consulting, hospital. These are some examples at a broad level, which we will dwell on. Then you identify your expenses. Then you have a contingency provision. So that is your financial planning, which you do. Financial planning is usually done in the beginning of the year. It is a longer term plan for you. And then the next level is budgeting and seeing whether you're able to break the financial plan into half yearly, quarterly, monthly budgets, monitor your financial plan against a yearly plan. So that is something which we need to do on an ongoing basis. Financial plan is yearly, budgeting is monthly, or in your comfort, whatever time periods you want. If it's okay, can I come out of the video because my network is little slow this time? Is it fine with all of you? Okay. Thank you. Then the next one is investing. So you have identified your financial plan. Now you know what your yearly goals are and whether your monthly or being able to achieve. So whether you are able to invest. So for investing, first of all, you'll have to define what risk you are able to take. If you're willing to take very high risk, you can go for shares. And if you don't want to take risk at all, you have to go for FD. But also depends on what your goals is. You might have a long-term goal. You might want to spend on some hospital, your children's education. So investing is all about identifying where your money is and what your risk appetite basically is. And also identify how liquid, how fast you need the money. So this is all about financial literacy broadly in three terms, which is basically saying beyond earning what financial management you need to do. So moving ahead, and you may all stop me if I'm slow, as I said, or fast, whatever, I leave it to you. So now this is something which I drew a simple flowchart to say how financial plan will be a long-term plan. Usually it is yearly. You draw something in the beginning of the year. So in a yearly plan, I will split it up into revenue and expenses. in revenue. I have just drawn this chart considering the doctor's specific requirements. You have a fixed salary, you have consulting fees, you know every month you're going to get. So that is split into something which I say it is certain money I'm going to get. And the non-fixed expenses, say hospital income, which you really don't know whether you're going to get 100 rupees or 1000 rupees or something, which I'm just giving an arbitrary number. So that is how I fixed into fixed and non-fixed. And in expenses, again, you have certain expenses which you know, which it says rent, rent, self-employed. If you're self-employed, you have rent, salary for staff, wages, and all of that. Then your house rental. So some component of it, I've also included the personal income to say that what you can be your yearly financial plan. The contingency plan here would be your expansion plan, your kids' long-term education. If you want to purchase a house or a hospital extra. So those are some things which I've divided into. So I leave it for some time if anyone has any questions on this one, or we can move ahead. So I'm just basically drawn up a yearly plan here. Nivedita, you want me to move ahead or?
Yeah, you can continue, madam.
Okay. Then the next one is, so when you know what your yearly plan is, I'm simply saying break the yearly plan into budget and make it more kind of monitoring. So here I have put in the top right, left-hand side of the chart as income, what you know. Your salary income, your consulting expenses, your hospital revenue. You can use your previous year hospital revenue, whatever you used as a benchmark to find out your total revenue. Because it is not fixed, you can go by the previous year revenue. Expenses, you know your household expenses, you know your hospital expenses. Just draw a broad idea about it on the right hand, on the left hand side of the chart. Keep at least 25% of it for contingency. Why I'm talking about 25% is there is some part of kids' education which we don't know, we don't anticipate, or there's some part of hospital expenses which we don't know and we don't anticipate. So what is there is income, which is known, and expenses. So this will give you a broad idea as to how you start your year with. Then you may have to break up this broad sheet into monthly budgets. If you could get someone to help you to draw, this is exactly the example Dr. Ramakrishnan sir was explaining as to how household women used to manage those figures. So I have drawn it like that. They also had their own way of drawing the expenses and revenue sheet. So revenue was you get from salary, consulting, and hospital. Expenses which you have for staff, purchases, and others. And the last part is C. So the final one in hand, you have A minus B minus C is what you have. But every month or every 3 months, please check whether it is in line with your year-end annual plan, which you have drawn on the left-hand side. So this sheet basically talks about set your goals. Yeah. This sheet basically talks about set your goal for the year, whole year. Analyze your revenue and expenses on a quarterly, monthly, whatever period you're comfortable with. Monitor them and again reevaluate whether you need to reset your year-end plan or look at where your budget is overshooting your plan. So this is the sheet on the second, the right hand, the plan, the left hand, the plan should move into your budget on your right hand. So now that you know you probably have some surplus cash in your hand, what investments you can make to make the money work for you rather than you work for the money. So these are something, again, here I would leave it to each individual preferences, but these are various types of investments you have. One is the risk, whatever basis your risk appetite, how much risk you're willing to take, what is your immediate liquid requirement, and what is your long-term goal should determine your investments. So here, there are various options available for you. One is the fixed deposits, one is bonds, one is gold, stock, then there is mutual funds, then there is PPF, exchange traded fund, national pension scheme, even real estate. So all of this should be basically driven by how much money you need for your immediate needs. And what is your year-end goal for finances? So I will just summarize this. Some of them, in terms of type of investments, what advantage you have, what disadvantage you have, and whether it can be long term and short term. So fixed deposits are the most liquid type of funds. So immediately you need any money, you can break a fixed deposit or take a loan against FD, and you will it can take care of both your short term and long term needs. You can also put in some money of your monthly consulting expenses, your fixed expenses, into recurring deposits. The only disadvantage here is it has very low rate of return. So if you are expecting a good rate of return, I would not suggest a fixed deposit. Next is shares. Again, it's very liquid. All of them would have DMAT accounts. The only disadvantage, the three main disadvantages, is highly volatile. There is a very high risk component. It needs to be tracked. You need to have an investment advisor who will constantly track this for you, and you need to have a knowledge of the market. It is preferable, though shares are very liquid, it is preferable to keep them long term because it will take care of some aspects of the volatility. Share markets can go up and down, but it's always seen that over a 10-year horizon, things stabilize. Mutual funds is a good alternate for people who want to invest in shares but are not willing to take so much risk. It is usually managed by a fund manager. The risk can be moderate to high risk. Debt funds are very moderate risk. Equity funds are high risk. Here you will have a guidance of a fund manager, but he will also charge you fund manager fees. Here again, it's preferable to keep it long term. You can start with something like investing on a monthly basis. It is called an SIP. Most of the banks have people who can help you with this one. Then PPF is relatively safe, but it is not liquid. It's again long term. National Pension Scheme of Government of India is again safe. There is no restriction in contributions. The flexible contributions are flexible. There are tax benefits. But again, you have some restrictions on withdrawal. The taxation is on withdrawal. There is no guaranteed return. Insurance is a must. I would say among all of this, all of us need to be insured. Especially term insurance. Whenever you do term insurance, don't try to link it with returns. You will not get any return, but it is something COVID times have taught us that insurance is the most important, which we underestimate. All of us, as doctors, we know how life is and what we have been through. So I would suggest all of us to go with the term insurance here. Then this is later. I have shared the links and the presentation also with Dr. Nivedita. She can read, these are some books which we can read on investments and budgets. These are very simple books for us to basically teach why is money important. And as I was mentioning earlier, it is not about earning, but it is also planning. So, and some websites and links where if you want to invest on something, I would urge you to even go through these websites before you finally decide invest money in a particular equity or mutual fund. There are many courses in Coursera and Udemy. These are, you know, these are flexible courses. They are free courses which you can just apply online and read it at your pace. So this is something which I thought I'll just leave you with on investments. Then I'm just coming to the final part of my presentation. Whenever, we are living in a world where loans are available all across, and at times we need to take loans. It's not about a man or a woman. Anyone needs to take a loan, maybe for their hospital, maybe for their education. But before we even get into the whole loan thing, we should understand why we need a loan. Should I take a personal loan, or if I have an FD, can I take an OD against FD? Would that hedge me better? Then should I take a personal loan in my name or the firm's name if you're having an expansion for the hospital? Draw up your repayment capacity whenever you take a loan. So that goes back to the first page where I did the budgeting. So basically try and understand whether you have cash flows to repay your loan. Then please try and understand from the banker from whom you're taking the loan that what happens if I start defaulting on my loan. See, the the whole bureau part has opened up all our personal loan records to the whole world. So if you default on your loan, that is, if you don't pay on the due date, there is a fair chance that you will be reported on bureau, and that will also in a way hamper your future loan borrowing. So whatever loans you take, try and understand from the bank branch head or the branch manager on your loan repayment and term sheets. So that's something you need to spend your time on, and you'll have to ask the bank what recourse they have if you default the loan. What have you mortgaged them? What have you given them as security? So I can take some questions later. And please read the loan document fully. So this is basically, I've tried to cover the entire structure from loan to loan. So I've just summed it all in one slide to say that what is investment planning and budgeting is to understand what your risk appetite at a personal level is, what your family's risk appetite, liquidity requirements are, and what do you want as long-term goals. Do you want to go in for hospital expansion? Do you want to spend on your kids' education? Whatever. Identify your revenues. The easiest way to identify your revenues to first start with what you earn in fixed, that is, you already know. Then go down to what you have earned in terms of consulting. And the last one is from your hospital. Then convert, try and convert as much as cash when you do even your hospital consultations to bank. It's very easy to track and monitor. And taxation, I would see, this is a very ever-changing subject, and every year there are changes. I would urge every one of you to have a professional tax consultant considering the various streams of revenue you have, and who engage with a tax consultant who doesn't talk about tax evasion, but tax management. By that, I mean that try and declare all your income. Don't go through tax evasion, because at some point in time, I mean, we live in a world where everything is transparent. You can be tracked with your PAN numbers. Form 26AS has all the details. So please have a tax consultant who teaches tax management within the realms of our tax rules and not tax evasion. Loans, if you're going, understand why you need the loan, whether it is for a long term or short term. Short term, you take a typical short term loan, an OD against FD or a personal loan for 12 months. If you need a long term, you go for a long-term loan, and read the loan document fully to understand your obligations. So this is all I have for you in terms of presentations. I would leave it to all of you for any questions. Thank you so much for listening. Dr. Nivedita, I leave it to you and Dr. Anush.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. It was very informative lecture. It was very brief. I think people have any questions, then the discussion may go forward.
Thank you, Dr. Shama, for your precise explanation about how to manage your and you beautifully explained about the game concept, goal setting, analysis, monitoring and evaluation. Exactly. Just like that, what we do, the SWOT analysis, something like that. So it is very nice, madam. And also you are told about how to get this thing about a loan, long-term investment, other things. And you are told about shares also. So one or two questions as a basic man who is also involved in the construction and the big ventures. Which is the best investment do you consider? For your personal opinion about investment, is it on shares? Somehow we need some more good returns for money. FD and all, now we cannot think of FD. In this era, what will be your opinion?
Dr. Nivedita,
please. Am I audible, madam?
Unmute yourself.
Sorry. Sir, yeah, sorry. I didn't realize. Am I audible now, sir?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So, sir, shares is any day a good investment. Suppose you're looking for liquidity in shares. So shares also, there are some stocks which are highly volatile. But if you have a very short span and your risk appetite is low, I would suggest you go for shares which are typically your, the Nifty top 50 shares and all of that. There the volatility will not be much. You will not have too much of risk, but you will get returns. But in typically in shares, no, sir, the shares are very volatile, but even out over a period of 10 years or 5 years. So even in shares, there's a longer term horizon which people look into, because you have seen the share markets, they touch the top and go down to the rock bottom and again stabilize at one level. So shares is something, if you're willing, you should be able to set aside at least 30% to say that I will take a high risk, and 70% set aside to say that I want it long term, I will use it for my long term projects. So that is how I'll see. In terms of return on, that's what I said, when you want to decide what type of investment you want, it has to be decided whether you want money immediately or over a period of long term. So if you want money immediately, park some funds in FD that gives you a flexibility of taking loan against the FD or liquidate the FD immediately. But if you want money over a long term and you are okay to take certain risk, shares is the best option. Again, mutual funds. If you're able to park some money on a monthly basis, there are banks which give loan against the mutual funds also. So that way you need not liquidate your mutual funds, but also make it liquid by taking a loan for a short period of time. So basis your liquidity, basis your long-term goals, you can make these investments. I hope I've answered your questions.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Any other questions from the audience? You can take up. There is a question. What is the difference between term insurance and life insurance?
I think term and life insurance mean the same. I'll have to check on that and get back. Probably some of them, can I reply over a question answer to Nivedita, no, ma'am, separately? Dr. Nivedita.
Can I answer, ma'am?
Actually, yeah, please.
Term insurance is the one we are investing for our life term. Suppose I have invested term insurance, correct. It's 1 crore policy. It is every year, every year or monthly we can pay, but we won't get any returns. And in the event of any unevent death, suppose we are investing it, it is not investment, it is kind of insurance.
Correct.
15 years, 20 years, any period you can have. Depends upon your age and all those things, it might weigh risk also. And after your death, our legal heirs will get the benefit. That is term insurance. We won't be getting anything in our lifetime. That is term insurance. Other LIC and all other insurance and all, it depends upon some tenure. After that, we might get the return. So that is the difference. So that is term insurance is for life risk purpose.
Yeah. So there are different, that's what I was trying to say, that term insurance, and there are various other types of insurance which LIC offers. There are private organizations like HDFC and ICICI offer. So in the slides which you would see of mine, I emphasize that don't link term with return. Term will never give you returns. Term is to hedge your dependence for any eventuality which happens to you. And it is better we always take a term insurance, because in the times of uncertainty which we are all living in, our dependents need to be hedged for anything which happens to us. And COVID is the best thing which has taught us that we should have all taken better term insurance. I think the term insurance premium is far lesser than the other mixed insurance. So LIC also has this plans called Jeevan Anand, and so much in Jeevan space itself, which links returns. That would be a better thing to see for returns on insurance policies. Term is separate. There are many plans which are linked with term. I would suggest that don't look at that, because that essentially gives you low return also. And the term part is slightly diluted.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am, which company term insurance will be best, ma'am, for future? Like if I want to take insurance for 35 or 40 years more into the future.
I think LIC is the best. That's my personal experience. But and the private, see, LIC, for whatever reasons, if you're going through their agent, they are able to do very good service. You just need to have a proper LIC agent who will guide you through the entire thing. And they have a good, their websites are also good. I think LIC was personally for my own, in my own family, when there was a demise, we had a better experience with LIC.
Oh, thank you.
Sorry, sir.
Ma'am, many want to know about cryptocurrency, ma'am.
Crypto is something which I am not sure. It's a new and evolving phase. There are many websites which discuss about crypto. I would not want to suggest on something which I personally, I am a risk averse person in spite of being in a bank. But crypto is something many websites also speak about. But it's a very evolving space, and it's very mathematical. We don't even know what goes inside that. So my advice there is very limited.
Yes, sir. Anyone else? There is a question.
There's a question about real estate as an investment option. Your views, ma'am.
Yeah. So real estate as an investment option, see, all of us think of real estate more as a security rather than an investment option. It is a good investment option, again, very long term, but there are various banks which again lend against real estate. So even if you're going for a hospital expansion or something, there are products which are called loan against property. So in one sense, it makes your real estate slightly liquid. The only thing is it also brings in a loan burden. Real estate is a good investment option, provided you're not doing too much of real estate, because in that way, your entire funds keep getting blocked. So when you do your liquidity planning, always ensure you have liquid funds in hand, because that will also mean you are able to meet your commitments on the loan against property which you have taken. So any plan, do it, but do in such a way that you are taking some money for your contingency and for your liquidity. But real estate is a good option.
I would like to add on, many of us can I speak, madam?
Yeah, please, sir.
Many of us doctors, they have, like what Radhika Reddy madam has just said, that we have some income which is shown and some income cash in hand, huh. Money. So real estate is good option for that. You can utilize your cash money in that.
Correct.
My 2 cents. Thank you.
Absolutely. That's what I'm saying. So if you're able to utilize your cash in hand, that's a good investment. And if it can also make it, you can also make it liquid by you taking a loan against the real estate, right? You have loan against properties offered by many financial institutions and banks. So you can also avail that. But whenever you do that, ensure that you have cash flows to service your loan. See, because we live in a world where everything gets reported to the bureau. So you have something called a bureau score. If all of you know about bureau, I'll not dwell on that, but I leave it to you if anyone wants to know about what a bureau is and how it works.
No, we don't know about bureau, madam. None of us.
Okay. So what typically happens is whenever you go for a loan to any bank, they take your application, you would see that they take your PAN number. When that's your unique identifier, right? So they'll take your PAN number. Whenever you avail a loan from the bank, whether you're repaying that on time, how many loans you have taken, how many times are you inquiring for a loan, there is granular level details which gets captured by bureau. So there are various bureaus in India. You can read up on that whenever you have time. It's one is called the CIBIL. CIBIL is the most popular bureau which collates all our personal information and says how our behavior is on the loan. Basically, are you repaying on time? How many loans have you taken? So there is a track record there. So one is the CIBIL, one is Experian. There are many various bureaus where your behavior on the loan side is tracked. So whenever you take a loan, just ensure you keep cash flows to make the loan repayment, because this not only affects your current loan, but in future, any bank you go, if you go to a different banker, he will first refer your bureau to say whether you have to, whether how much loan I have to give to you or whether I have to give you a loan or not.
Okay, so thank you.
Clarified.
Yeah.
Shyama ma'am, there are a few questions which I have charted from the chat box you have received.
Yes.
Can I ask that?
Sure.
Yeah. Now, first question was how to choose good portfolio in shares and what are the parameters to check when we invest in shares?
Okay. So when you have to choose a good portfolio in your shares, decide between the risk. I keep going back to the risk and the liquidity and your goals. So decide how much risk you're willing to take. See, because there are people who are willing to take a very high risk. There are people who are willing to take a very low risk. There are many YouTube websites which suggest how you'll have to do the entire portfolio management. Have a portfolio manager if you have a big portfolio stock. Any bank which you're doing, most of the private sector banks have a portfolio manager. Please ask the branch head that I want to talk to a specialized portfolio manager. Tell him your risk appetite. Ideally, if it were me, because I am a low risk appetite person, I will invest in shares which are top Nifty 50 to say that these are stable stocks, which will not be very volatile, but will give me returns like an FD. Of course, not 5%, more than that. Say, for example, a HDFC Bank, an ITC, or Axis Bank, where I come from. More or less, you see these stocks will be stable. They will have a particular rate of interest, and you know, even if I lose only so much, but if I gain also, you'll not gain too much, right? So the next is some moderate stocks. And the last one would be highly volatile stocks. Some of them are penny stocks. There are people who experiment on the penny stocks also. They are like fly by night, but when you make money, you make a lot of money. You lose money also, you lose a lot of money. So if you have funds, split it into three, decide your risk appetite, keep the safest bet, next one, and then if you want to experiment, keep 10% apart and say, even if I lose, it's okay, I will gain it in some other thing. But split your portfolio into three portions, keep a track, have a fund manager, and disclose all this to the fund manager that I have only so much risk appetite, but I have more. And there are months you may feel I can, you know, I have some surplus cash, I want to invest more on penny stocks or, you know, slightly riskier stocks. They'll be able to guide you.
Okay, ma'am. So next question was, any online platform that you suggest for learning about investment in stocks?
Investment in stocks, I was thinking there was someone was suggesting something called a Zerodha or something. I think that is, you can suggest, but there are various, you know, people who talk on YouTube. I think you can go through that. You can just in YouTube put a search that share suggestion. Some of them are very, very good. You can just go through some 10, 15 of them and decide what you want to go through that.
Okay. Next question was how to convert cash in hand.
How to convert cash in hand? That goes with your tax planning. You will have to sit with your tax planner and say that, you know, I need to convert this cash in hand because it will also have an implication of how much you wanted to give out money as a tax during the year end, right? All of you do your tax planning. So ideally, see, if it were me, with the way I keep telling that your PAN number links you to every source of income you have now. 26AS, if someone is deducting TDS for you, government can link back and say that you've got this consulting fee. So you have to decide what your investments are and then go back to the tax planner and say, I want to convert this into cash into bank. The best way is to convert it in the bank account, or I don't know, more than that is something which the tax planner has to guide you.
Okay, ma'am. I think only this much questions we received in the chat box.
Okay. I hope I've answered some of them.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am, very much.
I have one question about CIBIL, which you have spoken.
Yeah.
It's, even if you are paying back all the things, still the CIBIL score is around 800, 810 only. Why it is not close to 870,
880? So CIBIL score is, it's a very evolved score over a period of time. CIBIL started a lot of 10, 15 years back. So now what's happening is they not just look at to how much you're repaying, whether you're repaying in time. There is some concept of inquiries also, like, are you inquiring for a loan far too many times? is there your, you might have given an application to a DSA, he's going to four banks and giving your paper. So each bank, when they inquire against your PAN number, the score comes slightly down. See, what basically as a philosophy at the back end is thought is, the more you're inquiring, you are leveraged more. That means you're taking more loan. You may not be able to repay. CIBIL score is not just a reflection of your present payment, but also in future, whether you will be able to pay. See, because when you go to many banks now, they don't ask too many documents, especially private sector banks. They take a call on what data is publicly available and some information from you. So CIBIL score not just tells the present repayment capacity. In some sense, it says if he's inquiring more, maybe he'll take more loans in the future. So to that extent, it will reduce the score.
Ma'am, one more question. Any comments about 2022 salary new plan?
No, I don't have any. I'm not sure, so I don't have any comments.
Madam, one more question I want to have. There are so many app-based insurance consultancies. You compare insurance and pay here, phone pay, and so many people are coming with app and how to believe these people?
So, I would rather go to a personal insurance and talk face-to-face rather than app-based. Because, see, insurance is something which is a very, very personal thing. We need to build in our term part. We need to know our appetite. So, see, I don't know, for some reason, I trust to an LIC agent who at least tells me this is on face. So I would rather go in person rather than app-based. But someone was telling the car insurance part in app-based is very seamless. And he did not have a problem. So maybe leave your life and term insurance apart. For the car insurance, someone was suggesting that the app-based is much, much better than the going through the typical, the bank or LIC or no, so the bank part of it, ICICI or something.
Ma'am, one more question about the budget planning.
Yes, yes.
Suppose the liquidity and other plans and all we are telling, no? How to segregate how much liquidity we need and how much term insurance we have to plan and all those kind of planning. Can you give us some more idea about it?
Yeah, so what I was, so budgeting is something which is an ongoing thing and planning is in the beginning of the year. So like we are entering the new year, right? So you will have always a plan to say so much I have to earmark for my kids' education. Some of you might be wanting to open a new hospital. So always split revenue into what you're getting as salary and you know fixed you will get it. For example, you're working for Atma Hospitals, you know that this income will come on a fixed basis, come what may. Next is consulting. Every day, probably during few hours, you do consulting expenses. You know you'll be doing that for the next 1 year. So first salary, then your consulting expenses. You build a buffer saying Saturday, Sunday, I'm not going to go. So that how much will that expense reduce? Then the next one is, if you own a hospital or a new venture, you're not sure of how much income you will get. Benchmark with the previous year and say this is the maximum I'll get. Even if it increases, I know only more than this I'll not get. So your revenue is fixed. Then the next one is your expenses. In that expenses, divide long term and short term. Now short term is your household expenses, your clinic expenses, which have to be paid. You need to pay for salary. You need to pay for staff. All those are known expenses, but they are short term. Every month you have to pay. Then the next is long term. Are you going in for expansion of your clinic? Is your kid going in for a higher education, which you know in the beginning of the year? Then split in your revenue, set aside at least 25 to 30% depending on what you need as a long term expense. Because it will help you to build a buffer for 1 year down the line, you know, for your kids' education, in spite of education loan, you will be able to give in so much money. For your clinic expansion, you, in spite of taking a loan, your margin money is so much. So the loan amount at least will come down. So determine your liquidity. Then after that contingency, whatever comes, keep that as liquid funds to meet any contingency expenses. So when I have anyway shared the presentation with Dr. Nivedita, you can first build a year-end plan and then budget it accordingly on a monthly basis.
Some and people are saying 3 months of salary should be there in the liquidity in any case of emergency.
Exactly.
Or how much of term insurance, that is, suppose your family loses you, term insurance, it should be according to that, your value.
So
suppose
if term insurance, again, depends on the age of your dependents. If your kids are very, very young, I would urge you to take a bigger term insurance part. Because if they need to take care of, you know, probably you want your son to be a doctor like you. You know how much expenses, at least sitting now, you will take care of the inflation. Say, assume inflation is 5%, 10%. How much is there and how many dependents you have, depending on that, take term insurance, depending on the age of your kids. But if your kids are now itself in college, you know, you need to take care of them for the next 4-5 years only. But take care of that depending on the age of your dependents also.
Thank you, ma'am. I think few more questions are there in the chat. Dr. Elsie, can you ask that also?
Yes, ma'am. The other question is it advisable to change our current loans to other banks offering at low interest rate?
Yeah. So it depends on the type of loan. The loan component also has a portion of processing fee. So whenever you're changing banks, the other bank will also charge you a processing fee. So ask that upfront. You ask every fee. And if you're taking a housing loan, there'll be a charge on the registration part also. When you shift banks, you will have to do a re-registration for saying this property is mortgaged to the other bank. Evaluate basis. So if you're getting only 0.25 increase or decrease in the rate of interest, do a costing as to how much of processing fee the other bank is charging, how much is the registration cost, because every state the registration cost is different. Not all states have the same registration cost. With that, only you decide whether you need to shift banks.
Next question is it better to clear home or car loan foreclosure?
Foreclosure is always a good option. No? To that extent, you're loan free, right? So again, it goes back to what you want. If you have a lot of liquid funds and you don't want to block your funds and be loan free, foreclosure any day is good. But check the foreclosure charges. Some banks don't charge, some banks charge. So I think there is a tenor till which they don't charge, after which they charge. Check with your branches. He will tell you what are the foreclosure charges. If you're willing to let go of that also, it's okay. But after a period, I think none of them are charging nowadays foreclosure charges.
Other question is, in current scenario, fixed home loan is better or floater plan is better?
Floater, that I'll have to get back, ma'am, because I have taken a fixed, but mostly floater is doing well. In the current scenario, many of us are going for floater loans. It again depends on the interest rate scenario. Like for now, the interest rates are coming down. So if you see whoever has taken floater loans few years back, the interest rates have come down. But eventually, whether this will be the bottoming out and rates will come up, we don't know. So right now, I think floater interest rate is most of what most prefer. Because if you've seen over a 5-6 year period, rates have actually come down.
Okay. Other question is interest and earning? And is the interest saved due to foreclosure of loan and earning?
Earning. Interest is an earning. It is just a low rate of interest. And interest saved due to foreclosure is like an opportunity cost, right? So you know you could have, your money would have gone there, but you're actually making yourself liquid. So foreclosure is just making yourself having more cash in hand. But interest on FD is an earning. It's just a low rate of interest. That's all. Doctor, you were saying something.
Madam, there are so many banks. When you go for an investment, they're ready to come.
Yeah.
And there are a lot of competition among banks to give us loan. Because as a doctors, we are good repayers.
Correct.
And our risk factor is less.
Yes.
And they bargain interest in different ways, which is very unnatural. Give 2%, 3% difference about the rate of interest and other things. How to understand whether this will work it out or not? Some people say, application if we negotiate. We negotiate this. We negotiate. So many negotiations they come out. So, we are under a loss. Whether these people are reliable or not, long term, what they will do, that is because when you go for signing, there are 100 pages which you don't read at all.
Correct, correct. I understand.
And we can put this on 70 signatures. So this is a very situation. We are anxious, but anyway, we are putting the signature and getting the loan because they gave money. That is his thing. He is in Vaisar.
So, doctor, I would suggest whenever you go for a loan, suppose you're going for a personal loan, it's a simple thing. You're not mortgaging anything. It is a pure unsecured loan which you're taking. So, simple, your outgo would be your interest cost and your processing fee. That will be as simple as it is. So, you can still compare. You can just write interest cost and interest rate and processing fee and make a comparison across 3-4 banks. But whenever you're going for some loan where it is hypothecation of your hospital, current assets and mortgage of your fixed assets, that's where this whole concept of someone was asking me on foreclosure, the stamp duty of that place, because that is something which you'll have to give the state government. So you'll have to decide on the stamp duty part, the processing part. Your foreclosure is something upfront, please ask all the banks which are giving you. Because tomorrow, if you come with a very good option and you want to close and move, you should not be charged a foreclosure. That again is a loss for you. So interest rate, processing fee, taxes, if any, on the same thing, GST plus other taxes, the stamp duty charges, both on your hypothecation of current assets and your mortgage charges. The last one would be your foreclosure charges. Suppose you have liquid funds and you say, I want to be debt free. Please ask them upfront, when is the foreclosure charges coming? Basis that, and you tell them, I want to upfront, I might not have time to read 100 pages, but all the charges which you're giving me, you should just give me a loan document where I can just tabulate these charges and 4 banks, then you can decide which bank you want to go with.
Okay.
But did you have any kind of experience, sir, or doctor, with any
bank? Yes, ma'am. And now I'm going for a 40 growth project.
Okay.
For rehabilitation, re-addiction, other things. And I am a client of that bank, as you know. But loans as they are not good. So I'm HFC gives much better loan facilities. Though my primary account is with Axis Bank, and I get loan from Axis Bank, HDFC, and all. Because they're somewhat rigid and this thing. So that is the problem. Because people, some high value people, they say up to 8 crores I can give. Another bank says I can give up to 12 crores. See, this again is the difference which makes us confusion.
Correct.
One bank is giving 12 crores, why can't you give 10 crores? Something like that we are asking.
True, sir. I completely agree. Each one has their own loan assessment thing. And I understand how it is difficult. So that there again, when you also draw the chart of comparison, you should also see the loan amount and how much you need. Suppose your project itself needs 12 crores and some bank is saying, I'll give you 8 crores, but at a lower rate of interest, it might not help you because you will have to might be liquidate some other asset and give money here, which is not what you want. So when you draw that plan, also see how much loan amount you actually need and what is your repayment capacity also, sir. This is something which, you know, what happens when I'm giving my own experience, I may be right or wrong. We have a sense of optimism. Like, for example, 100 bed capacity in the prime city, we will assume at some level, this will also, if I open a hospital next door, the same 100 bed capacity will earn me the same income. That's how we all do our projections. We assume there is some optimism there. If we can moderate and say, also build maybe in the 100 bed capacity, what I was earning as 100 rupees here, just giving an example, I might earn only 80 rupees here. With that 80 rupees, whether I'll be able to service my loan is something we need to draw internally. We need not show it to the bankers. You can have a mental assessment with your tax planner to say, instead of 100, if I earn 80, what is my repayment capacity? So some bank who is giving you 12 crores also, but internally, if you know I can repay only 10 crores, I would be I would suggest you go with the 10 crores, sir, because all this affects your repayment, all this affects your bureau. And when you know, when bankers come, I am a partner in crime there. So when we come, we say you have to repay in 3 months. We don't stretch beyond 3 months. And 90 days for a doctor with your busy schedule, it is a lot to ask for, right? To go for that loan and repayment and all of that.
Thank you, ma'am. We have been very outspoken in this fact. Thank you so much. Is there any other questions?
Ma'am, two more questions, sir. One is, from your personal choice, if you have 50 lakhs liquid cash, how would you invest?
I am an FD person. I am a very bad risk appetite at the lowest I am.
Okay, ma'am. The other question is it better to deposit part-time consultation charges in bank in accumulated or weekly or monthly basis?
You can do it on a weekly or monthly basis. That should not be a problem. That's a flexibility you will have, because if you need something during weekends and all of that, I mean, that's internal flexibility depending on how your family expenses are.
Okay, ma'am.
Suppose we have sweeping account, those kind of things, that whenever we deposit money, that will go into that account, the interest will be accumulating, no, ma'am?
Yes.
Deposit little early.
I think HDFC still has that, ICICI has that. That's a very good option where you don't need to break your FDs, but doing that sweep in and sweep out. That's a good option. And loan against FD also. If you don't want to close any FD, better go for loan against FD. Do the sweep in and sweep out. It keeps your FD also liquid.
Ma'am, two more questions. What about investing on gold?
Investing on gold is a good thing, provided again, it also has a hassle. You know, there is a depreciating value. Investing in ornaments, you will, again, making charges and all of that, you probably will not get a good return. I think gold bars would be much better, but provided you manage the tax part of it, how you invest, that you need to have a proper person to consult that. There, investing in gold is a good option, but ornaments, typically on making charges and post that, you probably will not get a great return.
My other question is, mutual funds and stock market, any help?
Again, here you have professional managers in banks also. Many private sector banks have professional managers. You can consult any one of them. Go to them and tell the same thing which I said, right? Your risk, your liquidity, and your goals, whether it's long-term or short-term, they'll help you with some tax planning. Portfolio managers, these people are called. You can talk to them. Any branch bank or private sector bank will be able to help you there.
To have asked about gold bonds, to enlighten about gold bonds.
I'm not too conversant on that. Not too conversant.
Another question is, when loan interest changes, does the bank change automatically or do we have to inform?
I think most of the times the bank changes this automatically, but if you feel there is a lag, you can always drop a message to the bank. They will immediately change it.
They are not doing it, ma'am. It is a long process.
They are not doing it?
Not doing it.
Okay.
So we have to force them. It is in our benefit, we have to force them. But because in their benefit, they are doing it automatically. They are not asking us.
Okay, you're saying whenever there is increasing, they're doing it automatically.
Whenever there is an increase, they are doing without our knowledge. And whenever there is decrease, you have to ask them. There is a fee also.
That is the fee between the fixed and floating rate, I think.
No, ma'am.
No, madam, any rate of interest is reduced, they don't inform us. We have to fight for that.
Okay. I take this as a feedback, sir. For at least Access Bank is something I can give this feedback to them.
No, ma'am, can you give something about it? Is it provided by Axis Bank also? The housing loan insurance they are giving, no? The person who has purchased the house, he passed away, that will not burden the rest of the people. So can you enlighten us on that? What is the...
What would you need?
Yeah, in the housing loan, there is an insurance also covered that housing, who is doing it. So... suppose you have taken for 20 years, that person will be insured for 20 years for that value. In between, he passed away, that loan amount will be done by the insurance.
Yes.
The people in the family will get the benefit, that they need not pay anything. They can enjoy the home. So can you tell us the full detail?
Sir, I will not, probably Dr. Nivedita, these questions will need a much granular depth. I will probably get back to someone and give the full details, because okay, I cannot be giving half data on some of the insurance part. Maybe what we can do is some questions which I was actually not able to cover in full, I would suggest you could send me a mail. Let me connect with the right person and get back to you.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Any other questions?
I think no more questions, ma'am. Thank you so much for your patience and answering all the questions. I think Dr. Nivedita will be giving a thanking speech.
Thank you so much. It is my pleasure, and I'm really honored to be here because I know how much of service you all do to us. So it's my honor being here. Thank you so much for inviting me. I hope I was able to answer, if not all, some questions. So I'll leave it.
Definitely, ma'am.
Thank you, doctors. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Now, on behalf of the entire team of Samanvi, I primarily would like to thank our IPS South Zone President, Dr. Ramana Irat, sir, Honorable General Secretary, Dr. Suresh Kumar, sir, and all the office bearers of IPS South Zone for all the support and encouragement given to Samanvi and this webinar. We now would like to thank our immediate past president of IPS South Zone, founder, president of Samanvi, CEO of Atma Hospitals, consultant psychiatrist, and a kind and humble human being, Dr. K. Ramakrishnan, sir, for not only accepting our request to chair this session and be the chief guest today, but also sponsoring this webinar. Sir has also extended his help to sponsor all the webinars of Samanvi for the year 21-22. It has been a human experience to know that words fail to do their job in a few moments of life. And this definitely is one such moment when words fall short to convey our gratitude to you, sir. All we can say is thank you so very much. We would like to take this opportunity to thank the Atma Hospital support team of Mr. Salai Ital for conducting the webinar, from designing the invitation to taking the webinar so far and further. Thank you so much. I now have to thank Mr. Chandrasekhar Garu, Axis Bank Hyderabad, a brilliant chartered accountant himself, and his wife Soumya for introducing me to the speaker tonight. I now have to thank the star of the webinar today, Mrs. Kshama Raghavan, Madam, Vice President, Risk Department, Axis Bank, for enlightening us with such a feared topic of financial literacy. Thank you, ma'am, for bearing with us, taking out your precious time for us, and helping us in making the webinar, this webinar possible. I now have to thank our Samanvi chairperson, Dr. Radhika Reddy, ma'am, who responds immediately, enthusiastically, and only positively to all our requests for very successfully leading Samanvi in this second tenure as well. I have to thank our co-chairperson, Dr. Indumati, ma'am, for perfectly coordinating between all the groups to make the webinar possible. I now thank Dr. Aruna Yadiyal and Dr. Elsie Oman, members of Samanvi, for all their support and help given to the webinar today. Last but not the least, I would now like to thank all our distinguished guests and stalwarts who have attended the webinar today, like Dr. P. Raghuram Reddy, sir, Dr. IRS Reddy, sir, Dr. Meenad, sir, Dr. Sridhar Raju, sir, Dr. Narasimha Reddy, sir. I think if I have missed somebody, please do forgive me in person. I extend my thankfulness to one and all who have attended and made it possible today. I thank all the audience for sparing their time for this webinar on a Sunday and making this such a successful webinar. Hope the little effort by us will at least stimulate everyone to learn more in this vital field of knowledge called financial literacy. Please forgive me if I have missed anyone to thank in person. I sincerely thank one and all who have made this possible today, wishing you all a belated Merry Christmas and a very prosperous Happy New Year in advance. May Lord bless us all. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Nivedita. Very kind words. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Kshama. We'll keep in touch with you, madam, for any advice. that we may require in banking sector and all.
Thank you so much, sir. I mean, it's been really wonderful for me. Words fail me. Thank you, Dr. Nivedita, for introducing me. And it's been a real honor to be amongst you all. Thank you again.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Indumati.
Sir, thank you very much. Nagada Mook Salana, sir. So kind of you.
So money, very good. And I want to make one more thing. This thing to add. We are the voice of women psychiatrists. Or if you can put one more word, something like that, it may be more catchy.
Okay, sir. Along with Samanvi, you are telling the invitation itself.
Voice of women psychiatrists. That one word.
Okay, sir. We'll.
So that more women can join. That it is for you. We are doing. You have to join. There are more than 300 women psychiatrists in Tamas also. And people, only 70 people have joined. Even male have more attendance than females.
Yes, sir.
Maybe we have to stimulate. Yes. So that's what I was thinking about when I saw, why can't it be a voice of women psychiatrists?
Okay. Okay, sir. We'll try to.
Okay, sir. Suresh Maji.
Yes. Namaste, sir. please, sir. Please welcome, sir. The next minute is also joined, sir. Just you want to invite all the our members to participate in ANSIPS at Visakhapatnam. Please do come, sir. Please. Yeah. Please don't fear about Omicron and all. It keep coming.
I don't
request all of you.
Definitely.
I know, sir. You are so dynamic. The rest of the people also, I am inviting to attend ANSIPS at Visakhapatnam. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Suresh, sir. Sir, we have to stay back. Want to discuss anything or next time we'll have it, sir?
As Ramanan sir is not there, okay, you can speak internally at your level. Madam is covering two programs, I think.
No, I am listening to you.
Background is different, madam.
Yeah. And every Dr. IRS sir is waiting and everybody is here. All the Vijayawada psychiatrists.
Okay, carry on, madam.
Here, all these people have joined, actually. So, okay, they didn't join individually. Many questions are from our audience here. I have.
Okay.
So, you have connected both the programs.
Yes.
Rather
yes.
Than
Yes, yes.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you. Enjoy. Thank you very much for
thank you.
Nice lecture and nice Nivedita.
Thank you.
A good Thanksgiving is there.
Thank you. Yeah.
It's like an official formal speech kind of thing. It's very nice.
Okay, ma'am. Pardon me, I'm leaving.
Yes, ma'am. Bye, ma'am.
Bye, ma'am.
Dr. Elsie, bye.
Bye, ma'am.
You are mute. Dr. Aruna, could not come in video, I think. Dr. Aruna? See you. Okay, Dr. Nivedita. See you.
Okay, ma'am. Bye. See you, ma'am. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Dr. Nivedita.
Madam, good evening. Thank you.
Sir. Okay, sir. Every in this program useful.
Lunch, ma'am. Romba useful. Romba useful.
நிறைய க்வெஸ்சன்ஸ் கொஞ்சம் சிம்பிளா தான் இருந்தது மேடம் கொஞ்சம் தயங்கி தயங்கி பதில் சொன்னாங்களோ கொஞ்சம் யோசனையா இருந்தது அந்த
என்ன தெரியுமோ நல்லா
சொன்னாங்க நம்மளுக்கு தான் அது கொஞ்சம் இதா இருந்ததோ நம்மளோட லெவலுக்கு தெரியல எனக்கு இது இது இந்த லெவல் கரெக்டுங்களா சார் இன்னும் கொஞ்சம்
கரெக்டா
இருந்தது ஓகே ஓகே அனுப்பிடுறேன்
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Bye, sir. Good night.